much for joining us. We're here with Adrian and Joni here at JPL. And today we are talking about Cassini and internship opportunities for high school and college students here with College Web Media. So before we begin, do you guys have a website that we can send our audience to?
Sure. For Cassini, we go to saturn.jpl.nasa.gov, and there's a lot of information about stuff going on with the mission there.
Okay, saturn.jpl.nasa.gov.
Yes.
Perfect.
Sure, and if you're interested in internships at JPL, if you Google internships in JPL, you come up with the top hit, and you can learn what programs are available and apply there.
Internships at JPL, fantastic, thank you so much. So if it's all right, I'd like to jump right in. Could you guys tell us a little bit about your education background? Whoever wants to go first?
Sure. I got my undergraduate degree in aerospace and mechanical engineering at Rensselaer Polytechnic Institute.
Okay.
It's in Albany, or near Albany in New York.
Okay.
And then I got my master's in aerospace engineering at the University of Illinois.
Okay, fantastic. So you've been all over the place.
All over, marching west.
Very nice.
And, I'm a chemist, so I did my undergraduate at Michigan State University, and then graduate work here at Caltech in Pasadena for a PhD in chemistry.
And now you guys are both here at JPL?
Yes,
we are.
So along the way, did you guys have any mentors? And for that matter, do you still have mentors that guide you?
Sure. I mean, for me, when I was an undergraduate, I was first person in my family to go to college. I had no idea what I was getting into. And one of my professors kind of made me aware of the possibility of internships to do research in science. And so I started bugging him on a daily basis whether or not I could basically start working in the lab and stuff. And so eventually I got that opportunity, and it was really a game changer. And so I'll talk a little bit more about internships and impacts and so on. But that was a big impact for me, is to kind of operate at the frontier of human knowledge, doing research, and you really get a perspective of all these hard classes that you're taking, mm-hmm. you know, calculus, physics, and chemistry, and so on. When you actually apply that stuff to work on a problem, like I said, at the frontier of human knowledge, it really pushes you to do well in those classes and to finish those classes and to get your degree.
And now, do you mentor other students now that you're on the other
side? Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, and so, you know, I got my degree and a job here at JPL, which is very exciting because I always have been into space exploration as a kid. I started a kind of a research lab funded by NASA, kind of small projects, research projects, and I would bring on students to help with the research and to also give them a good educational experience. And so I've had about 50 or so students, undergraduate, graduate, some high school, working with some faculty that come and visit, postdocs, and so on.
Fantastic. So you have tons of people who have come through the program.
Right. For me as a researcher. And then later on, I got a job in the education office here at JPL because I enjoy this, mentorship element so much. I kind of wanted to work for the part of the lab that makes that benefit available for the rest of the lab. The education office connects mentors at JPL, and we have about 600 or so mentors here with the students that want internships, and we bring in about 1,000 students or so per year. So it's
bringing it back, fantastic.
Right.
Joni, do you have any mentors that have really stood out?
I had one professor in undergrad at RPI. So RPI is really, really strong in aerodynamics and that kind of thing. And they have some good space classes, but that's not their first and foremost focus. So one of the professors that taught all the space classes sort of really helped me get passionate about it. And he actually was the one that was, you know, sort of encouraging me to look at JPL and mm-hmm. that kind of thing.
How exciting. So now you're at JPL. So now what is your role here at JPL now?
My role is I am a guidance and control engineer for the Cassini spacecraft mission. So I work on the operations team. And so my job is to worry about pointing the spacecraft cameras and instruments to get data for the scientists.
Okay. We're going to come back to that.
Okay.
A lot of questions I'd like to ask
sure.
about Cassini. But before we get into that, you know, there are a lot of people that say, you know, we need to cut funding, let's cut it in space exploration. What would you say to those people about why it's so important to study space?
There's so many reasons.
Well, I mean, it's really a part of being a human being is to better understand our place in the universe. That's the kind of question that NASA is beginning to answer is, you know, we're learning about planets around other stars for the first time. We can detect them and see that they're there. We're looking on places in our solar system for evidence of habitability and even life, going to Mars. We're formulating missions to go to Europa, where there might be a liquid ocean, underneath the ice there. And so those things, you know, ever since humanity gathered around fires, have been wondering about these big questions. And NASA is where we come together as citizens and as part of the country to answer those questions and to be inspired. And the kind of spin-off benefit to that is, you know, you have the next generation wanting to become engineers, scientists, doctors. That's where the discoveries are going to be made for the betterment of our society.
Absolutely.
Yeah, that's usually what I start with, and most people are okay with that, but some people, you know, push further and say, well, what about something now? An example that I always give for that is, well, so Saturn is a giant ball of gas, and storms happen on Saturn in very similar ways to the ways that they happen on Earth. So by studying the dynamics of the atmosphere on Saturn, we can actually learn a lot about the dynamics of the Earth's atmosphere as well. So that's a lot of practical applications too, not just the betterment of human society, which is an important reason.
And to kind of underscore that further, you know, and I mentioned my research earlier, which had to do kind of with astrobiology, studying microbial life in extreme environments on Earth. That was kind of the research my group was doing. And as part of that sort of space-related research, we learned how to build instruments that can measure whether or not microbes are alive or dead. Mm-hmm. And now there's kind of a spin-off company that is formed, a Caltech spin-off, that is developing technologies for looking at microbial contaminations in hospital. Mm-hmm. And so hospitals, acquired infections kill about 100,000 people per year in the United States alone. And technology like this that was originally inspired and developed by NASA will hopefully put a dent into that number. So,
so from space to the hospital.
Exactly.
So getting a little bit more specific, could you give us a little bit of background on Cassini?
Sure. So Cassini was launched in 1997, so it's an old mission. It got to Saturn in 2004, so it took a long time to get there. And we've been orbiting Saturn ever since. We fly by the moon Titan pretty frequently, and we get some flybys of some of the other moons as well. But we've been there for 7 years, and we're in our second extended mission. So the first one went really well, and so we got it extended, and then we got it extended again. So the mission is due to end in September of 2017.
Okay.
And before we do that, we're actually going to plunge through the inner part of the rings and the top of the atmosphere. We're going to do that several times, and we've never been in that environment before, so we're all excited about that.
That is exciting. Yeah. I can't wait to see the images that come out of that.
Yeah.
So September 28th. Speaking of flybys, I believe Cassini is scheduled for a flyby of Titan.
Enceladus?
Enceladus.
That's okay. Yeah, so Enceladus is one of the moons of Saturn that people are really excited about. It's an icy shell covering a small liquid water ocean. And as it goes around Saturn, the gravity pulls the ice apart, and so there's cracks in the bottom, and so you actually get huge plumes of ice particles flying out.
Okay.
So there's some really cool images that you can find online of that. We're actually going to be flying through those plumes.
Wow.
Coming up. Yeah.
Is there anything that you're hoping, anything specific that you're hoping to learn with this flyby? Anything that you're expecting, or?
The scientists, I think, are just really interested in learning about the composition of the water underneath the surface.
Okay.
Learning more about that.
Okay. Yeah. And earlier we were talking about how, you know, discoveries in space impact us here at home. What kind of discoveries from the Cassini mission have impacted us here at home, as we were discussing earlier? So any technologies that are used in other fields or any information that other scientists might use?
I mean, that's an excellent question. I'm not quite sure about that one. I mean, the best example that I think I mentioned before is the learning about the dynamics of the atmosphere.
Okay.
But the learning about Enceladus also teaches us a lot about other icy moons. And I think Adrian mentioned Europa. And that's another one that we're going to be sending a mission to soon. And so there's some similarities between those types of moons. So that's also helping.
Okay. All right. And from an engineering standpoint, what would you say was the biggest obstacle to overcome with Cassini?
Well, let's see. So I've only been on the mission for 2 years.
Okay.
So there have been a lot of challenges that I've sort of heard about, but I really wasn't there for. One of the big challenges that people were worried about was the deployment of the Huygens probe.
Mm-hmm.
So Cassini launched and got to Saturn and had the Huygens probe attached to it, which was a probe that actually detached from the spacecraft and landed on the surface of Titan.
Okay.
And gave us some cool videos and pictures and that kind of thing as it was going down and as it landed. But it was a pretty large thing. And so when it detached, the force kind of actually caused Cassini to tumble a little bit. So that was something that people were a little concerned about.
Okay.
In general, Cassini has been a very well-behaved, knock on wood, mission. So we've had many fewer anomalies and that kind of thing than a lot of other missions have. So we've been very lucky.
So, but when things do go wrong, how do you tackle that from so far away?
So what happens is the spacecraft immediately shuts off all non-essential things, like all the science instruments, so the scientists stop getting data. And the spacecraft turns and points its antenna towards Earth, and then it basically just sends a whole bunch of engineering telemetry, which is the data from the spacecraft. And we receive that on the ground, and then it's sending that, and then it just listens. So that gives the engineers a chance to go through all of that data that it just sent us, and we can look through and try and figure out what happened. And once we sort of formulate an idea of what happened and manage to run through simulations and run through some tests, then we can figure out a fix, and then the spacecraft sitting and listening for the fix that we send up to it.
Wow, NASA thinks of everything.
So,
you know, we've heard the term failure is your friend. To what extent is that true at JPL and at NASA? Is it very common to learn from mistakes before a mission, or is that usually in the middle of a mission you...
Well, I don't know, do you have anything to say?
Well, I think, the learning from the mistakes, I think you've already said it, is a key part of technology development. Of course, you try to anticipate them and eliminate risk and so on, but still, at some point you have to build something, turn it on and test it, and when it fails, you diagnose what went wrong, you have your lessons learned, and you apply those for the next design. And so, with failure, you actually sometimes learn more than when everything is just going perfectly, but because it pushes the design to the next level.
Okay.
And I think that's one of the reasons why JPL does so well in the robotic spacecraft exploration is that we have a really long history. So we have a lot of people on lab that have been working here for many, many years. And so they've seen the types of failures and that kind of thing that occur on other spacecraft. And so we have a very large knowledge base for when we're planning for future missions. So,
okay, so and we take knowledge from past missions and
learn.
Apply it.
Yep.
Fantastic. And for our female audience, would you guys say that space is still very male dominated, or is that changing?
I think it depends on the kind of the different fields within space, I'd say.
Okay.
I think on lab we have a pretty good ratio of men to women. My section in particular is the guidance and control section, and that is definitely more male dominated. So.
Okay. And Adrian, this question is more directed for you, but in terms of internship opportunities,
sure.
Could you tell us about opportunities, especially for students at schools that might not have the greatest resources?
Sure. I mean, we have a lot of different programs at JPL that we host. And again, you can find them by Googling internships, JPL, and having a look. We work a lot with local community colleges, for example, to bring in the students there that are interested in research and are ready to come in. We have kind of a pipeline even where students from places, you know, let's say a community college might not have a lot of experience in research and so on, to first come to JPL and see what internships are about, to kind of observe the internship without participating in the actual research, but to have access to the seminars, to the enrichment activities, the social activities, to make connections and make a network, so that when they do apply subsequently, that they have something on their resume, that they have a network of people that they've met, and so on. So I think that's one area where we kind of have a thrust is in community colleges. And we also work a lot with minority serving institutions to help diversify the population that's in STEM, that's science, technology, engineering, and math. And so we actively pursue that. But in general, you mentioned females in STEM and engineering and math and science and technology. That's an area that we're focusing on as well to diversify. So if you're a young woman out there, please have a look at JPL. There are lots of great opportunities for you. So definitely encourage that.
Fantastic. And you know, when I was in high school, I used to hear everyone talk about internships, how important internships are. Without really knowing, you know, what is an internship? What does a day in the life of an intern look like? So could you talk about the different kinds of projects that interns might work on?
Sure, and I mean, you're exactly right, first of all, to point out that an internship is really a game changer, a transformative event for many of the students that come through, including myself. I told you my story. And that's by and large true. It looks great on a resume, but it also really changes how you think about the technical major that you're pursuing. In terms of opportunities here, you know, at JPL, we do the full mission life cycle. There's research and development, there's technology development, there's missions that are in a formulation stage, missions that are being developed and planned and implemented, and science that's coming back for missions. So there's a whole life cycle in a mission, and we plug in interns across that whole spectrum. So they might work, you know, with the data sets that are coming down from Cassini, the Enceladus flyby, or for the Mars missions and so on. There are students that work in formulation offices that figure out what technologies are needed, what the trade-offs are, a lot of software development or computer science skills that are needed for the internships here, for design, for big data, for analysis. So it's really across the whole spectrum of STEM. Mm-hmm.
And so it sounds like there's something for everyone who's interested.
Absolutely. And you know, and be flexible. And one piece of advice would be, don't be stuck with necessarily only what your current interest is. Open your mind a little bit to the possibility of doing something new that you might not have considered, but when you see it as an opportunity, go ahead and give it a shot and apply.
Yeah, I'd say to add to that, I actually started off in a slightly different area of engineering, of aerospace engineering. I was focusing more on navigation stuff. And there weren't any opportunities at JPL, and so I was hired into the guidance and control, and it turns out I actually like the guidance and control stuff better. So you kind of, you may think you know what your interests are, but when you actually start doing it, you might learn something new. Yeah, exactly.
Speaking of advice, actually, I want your job. Could you give advice to college students like me who want to work at JPL, want to be engineers, and want to be doing the things that you guys are doing here at JPL?
Sure. I mean, I've already said it. I think that, you know, doing an internship is a way to figure out what you really can be passionate about. In some internships, students come in and they say, oh, I definitely don't want to do that. That's a great conclusion to have, because now you know you don't want to do that, and you can try something else. But you know, a lot of times, you know, the internship, like I said, is a transformative element in an educational experience going forward. It propels them into graduate school, and they become, you know, postdocs, and then have their own careers developing. I'm a scientist, you know, a research laboratory, or if you're an engineer, you become a lead on a mission, or if you go into industry, cars, or whatever the topic is. So I really push the internships, and that's why I guess steered my own career towards helping other people, other students gain internships and making that connection, that bond between the mentor and the student.
Fantastic. Anything you'd like to add?
I'll agree for sure that internships are really important. I had internships at three different places, none of which were JPL actually, and ended up at JPL, and it's a really good place for me to be. I guess the other things about JPL specifically that I noticed that's very different from a lot of the other places that I had internships is that almost everyone here is very passionate about their work. And so I think that if you want to be working at JPL, you should develop a passion for space.
Okay, great advice.
Yeah, absolutely.
So shifting gears a little bit, if that's all right.
Sure.
Have you guys, we have tons of social media popping up everywhere. Have you noticed that JPL has benefited from social media in terms of gaining public interest, or how has social media played a part?
Well, the education office and the communications offices are in the same directorate, and so I hear a lot about what our social media folks are doing. And it's just really amazing the reach that they have, in the US globally with the different opportunities, the different events that are coming out. Social media has been a game changer for us to reach the public and to inspire folks out there. So it's really important. And I think we have a particularly strong team. I think they win all kinds of awards with Webbies and so on. So.
Yeah, yeah, NASA has it all figured out. So speaking of buzz, there's been a lot of buzz around the movie The Martian.
Yes.
It's coming up pretty soon. Do you guys feel that Hollywood has gotten more responsible in terms of science movies that are about outer space now that, we actually are in space?
That's an interesting question because the Martian, the movie is based on the book, and mm-hmm. the book is very, very true to engineering and that kind of thing. And so, the director, has made a decision to try and stay true to the science and that kind of thing. But mm-hmm. but I do think that as NASA does a better job at communicating the exciting things that we're finding in space, mm-hmm. I think that the public responds to that. And so I think they're, people want to see more space movies. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, didn't you think Star Wars and Star Trek were true to life? No, I mean, I think it's interesting, there's been a series of movies. I think Gravity was kind of considered have that real experience of space, and it was really gripping, I think. Of course, there are a lot of issues with it, which Neil deGrasse Tyson would be happy to point out in detail. But The Martian, of course, is just a very interesting combination of the things that grip us, Mars, survival, using the tools of that you have at hand, and living off the land, so to speak. Which is really part of the American spirit, I think, to some degree, is the frontier of mentality. So I think it's really captivating a large audience, and at the same time showing that being a student, learning about those things can be a really cool thing. So
absolutely. I know that I'm thrilled to see how it comes out.
Yeah, absolutely. Me too. I haven't seen it yet, so I've read the book.
Yeah, it comes out, October. So
right.
Yeah, we're all excited.
Counting down the days. Yeah, well, I think that those are all the questions we have. Thank you guys so much for joining us.
Thank you.
Really appreciate it.
Thank you.